Hello everyone, welcome to the YouTube channel J Sri Jawaji. Today we shall continue reading the book The Richest Man in Babylon by author George S. Clason, part 14. For 2 years I had a restless and unsuccessful life working for caravan traders. From this I fell in with a set of likable robbers who scoured the desert for unarmed caravans. Such deeds were unworthy of the son of my father, but I was seeing the world through a colored stone and did not realize to what degradation I had fallen. We met with success on our first trip, capturing a rich haul of gold and silks and valuable merchandise. This loot we took to Guinea and squandered. The second time we were not so fortunate. Just after we had made our capture, we were attacked by the spearsmen of a native chief to whom the caravans paid for protection. Our two leaders were killed and the rest of us were taken to Damascus, where we were stripped of our clothing and sold as slaves. I was purchased for 2 pieces of silver by a Syrian desert chief, with my hair shorn and but a loin cloth to wear. I was not so different from the other slaves. Being a reckless youth, I thought it merely an adventure until my master took me before his 4 wives and told them they could have me for Enoch. Then indeed did I realize the hopelessness of my situation. These men of the desert were fierce and warlike. I was subject to their will without weapons or means of escape. Fearful I stood as those 4 women looked me over. I wondered if I could expect pity from them. Sarah, the first wife, was older than the others. Her face was impassive. As she looked upon me, I turned from her with little consolation. The next was a contemptuous beauty who gazed at me as indifferently as if I had been a worm of the earth. The 2 younger ones tittered as though it were all an exciting joke. It seemed an age that I stood waiting sentence. Each woman appeared willing for the others to decide. Finally, Cyrus spoke up in a cold voice. Of Enochs, we have plenty, but of camel tenders, we have few and they are a worthless lot. Even this day, I would visit my mother who is sick with the fever and there is no slave I would trust to lead my camel. Ask the slave if he can lead a camel. My master thereupon questioned me, "What know you of camels?" Striving to conceal my eagerness, I replied, "I can make them kneel, I can load them, I can lead them on long trips without tiring. If need be, I can repair their trappings." "The slave speaks forward enough," observed my master. "If thou so desire, Sarah, take this man for thy camel tender." So I was turned over to Sarah, and that day I led her camel upon a long journey to her sick mother. I took the occasion to thank her for an intercession, and also to tell her that I was not a slave by birth, but the son of a free man, an honorable saddle maker of Babylon. I also told her much of my story. Her comments were disconcerting to me, and I pondered much afterward on what she said. "How can you call yourself a free man when your weakness has brought you to this? If a man has in himself the soul of a slave, will he not become one, no matter what his birth, even as water seeks its level? If a man has within him the soul of a free man, will he not become respected and honored in his own city, in spite of his misfortune? For over a year, I was a slave and lived with the slaves, but I could not become as one of them. One day, Sarah asked me, in the even time when the other slaves can mingle and enjoy the society of each other, why dost thou sit in Thailand alone? To which I responded, I am pondering what you have said to me. I wonder if I have the soul of a slave, I cannot join them, so I must sit apart. Teach you must sit apart. She confided, "My dowry was large and my lord married me because of it. Yet he does not desire me. What every woman longs for is to be desired. Because of this and because I am barren and have neither son or nor daughter, must I sit apart? Were I a man, I would rather die than be such a slave. But the conventions of our tribe make slaves of women. What think thou of me by this time?" I asked her suddenly, "Have I the soul of a man, or have I the soul of a slave? Have you a desire to repeat the just debts you own in Babylon?" She parried, Yes, I have the desire, but I see no way. If thou contently let the years slip by and make no effort to repay, then thou hast but the contemptible soul of a slave. No man is otherwise who cannot respect himself, and no man can respect himself who does not repay honest debts. But what can I do who am a slave in Syria? Stay a slave in Syria, thou weakling. I'm not a weakling, I denied hotly. Then prove it, how? Does not thy great king fight his enemies in every way he can and with every force he has? Thy you left them alone and they grew too strong for thee. Hadst fought them as a man, thou couldst have conquered them and been one honored among the townspeople. But thou had not the soul to fight them, and behold, thy pride has gone down until thou art a slave in Syria. Much I thought over her unkind accusations, and many defensive phrases I worded to prove myself not a slave at heart, but I was not to have the chance to use them. 3 days later, the maid of Syra took me to her mistress. My mother is again very sick, she said. Saddle the 2 best camels in my husband's herd. Tie on what skins and saddlebags for a long journey. The maid will give thee food at the kitchen tent. I packed the camels, wondering much at the quantity of provisions the maid provided. For the mother dwelt less than a day's journey away. The maid rode the red camel which followed, and I led the camel of my mistress. When we reached her mother's house, it was just dark. Syra dismissed the maid and said to me, Debasir, hast thou the soul of a free man or the soul of a slave? The soul of a free man, I insisted. Now is thy chance to prove it. Thy master hath imbibed deeply, and his chiefs are in a stupor. Take then these camels and make thy escape. Here in this bag is raiment of thy mistress to disguise thee. I will say thou stole the camels and run away while I visited my sick mother. Thou hast the soul of a queen, I told her. Much you, I wish that I might lead thee to happiness. Happiness, she responded, awaits not the runaway wife who seeks it in far lands among the strange people. Go thy own way, and may the gods of the desert protect thee, for thy ways is far and barren of food or water. I needed no further urging, but thanked her warmly and was away into the night. I knew not this strange country and had only a dim idea of the direction in which lay Babylon, but struck out bravely across the desert toward the hills. One camel I rode and the other I led. All that night I traveled, and all the next day, urged on by the knowledge of the terrible fate that was meted out to slaves who stole their master's property and tried to escape. Late that afternoon, I reached a rough country as uninhabitable as the desert. The sharp rocks bruised the feet of my faithful camels, and soon they were picking their way slowly and painfully along. I met neither man nor beast, and could well understand why they shunned this inhospitable land. It was such a journey from them then on as few men live to tell of. Day after day we plodded along. Food and water gave out. The heat of the sun was merciless. At the end of the 9th day, I slid from the back of my mount with a feeling that I was too weak to ever remount. And I will surely die, lost in this abundant country. I stretched out upon the ground and slept not, waking until the first gleam of daylight. I sat up and looked about me. There was a coolness in the morning air. My camels lay dejected not far away. About me was a vast waste of broken country, covered with rock and sand and thorny things. No sign of water, not to eat for man or camel. Could it be that in this peaceful quiet I faced my end? My mind was clearer than it had ever been before. My body now seemed of little importance. My parched and bleeding lips, my dry and swollen tongue, my empty stomach, all had lost their supreme agonies of the day before. I looked across into the uninviting distance, and once again came to me the question, have I the soul of a slave or the soul of a free man? Then with clearness, I realized that if I had the soul of a slave, I should give up, lie down in the desert and die a fitting end for a runaway slave. But if I had the soul of a freeman, what then? Surely I would force my way back to Babylon, repay the people who had trusted me, bring happiness to my wife who truly loved me, and bring peace and contentment to my parents. Thank you. We shall continue with next video. Stay tuned. If you like the video, please like, share, and subscribe.